Are you not entertained? We're just like, isn't this what you came here for?
Corey Taylor, nice to see you, mate. How are you?
I'm good, man. How you doing?
I'm not too bad. You look very well indeed. First of all, I just want to say congratulations, because as we all now know, you've got a new dog.
I do have a new dog, Spud. Let's see if I can remember his full name.
Okay.
His full name is Spud Picles Bud Wolfman Taylor. Yeah, it's a long one. It's a family name, but you know, it's...
Well, did you all have a name in mind and you just couldn't quite decide, so you just gave him the whole lot?
Let's just say yes to all of that, and we'll crack on, because he's a good boy. Let's put it that way. Like, the first thing I did when I got him is he crawled up in my arms and just started chewing on my chin. I posted that video on Insta, and that was real. That was as real as it gets. So,
I mean, I tell you what, I mean, it looks like love at first sight to me. You adore him already, don't you?
Yeah, he's pretty special, man. He's super chill. He's very smart. And he's probably one of the coolest dogs I've ever had. Like, just really, yeah. And he's super, like, he's really young. He's only like, 8-9 weeks now, I think. So,
and he's a rescue too, which I applaud you for.
Yeah. All of our dogs are rescues. Like, I keep telling Alicia, we're going to have to get a bigger house, because she's the one, she's the instigator that goes out of there, and she just keeps sending me pictures, and she's just like, oh, and then I get the doe eyes, and I'm like, no,
yeah,
we can't.
My wife and your wife would get on. My wife is exactly the same. She sends me pictures of cats down the cattery saying, look at this one, it's got three legs and one eye. We've got to have it.
Right. Yeah, I know. And it's just like, if I could, I'd save them all. Man.
Exactly. Like, why wouldn't you get a rescue? That's what I wonder these days. But no, he looks adorable. He looks like a spud as well, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
Cheeky, but adorable, a bit like your good self.
Right, exactly. He's going to be able to himself.
They do say that dogs look like their owners, by the way. I'm just putting that out there.
Well, you know, it's, you know, I don't have the spots yet, but I'm going to the tattoo shop as soon as possible to just kind of get it all over on one side.
Good man. Joking aside, we do have a proper celebration on our hands, though, with UK number one album for the end so far. Congratulations.
Yeah. Thank you, man. Yeah, it's... I believe, oh, here we go. Spray it. I believe this is our second in a row too, which is really cool. You hope for it, but you never plan for it. And it's, we're over the moon, extremely stoked, and really lucky to be here.
When did you find out? Was this like mere hours ago? Were you keeping tabs on it as well?
I literally found out like 2 hours ago. Yeah, like for real. Like, you, because everybody's numbers comes out differently. You know, like every night, like they cut off in the States today, but you don't get the numbers till Sunday. I was like, that's some like American election shit. You know, like you're stunned. You know what the hell is going on? But, it's fine, because the UK is just so much quicker that we were over the moon. And it's just another reason for us to celebrate the fact that we're still here doing it at this level, this big. I mean, we're just like, really? Okay.
It's pretty incredible. It really is. I think I remember talking to you a couple of years ago when you were in Birmingham. And at the time, I think you were celebrating your 20th anniversary or 25th. I've lost count of years. And you were saying you just can't believe that all those years ago when you first started the band, here you are all this time later, still doing it, still crushing it.
Yeah. I mean, it's a good problem to have. Let's put it that way. It's, you know, and it's a good crew, man. We still lead with our heart when it comes to the music. We still try to make it as creative and as exciting as possible. The passion is still there. We still like to throw people for a loop when it comes to like what we put out. We just still love doing it, man. You know, we just still love the music that we put out. I think that's the combination. Plus you're talking about a band that everybody wants to hear. So, you know, it's the perfect storm of longevity, really, you know, which if you'd have told me it was Slipknot years ago, I would have laughed at you. And yet here we are. Like, it's crazy.
You're almost getting better with age. That's the kind of crazy thing about the whole situation. Yeah. And your UK fans, I mean, let's just touch on them for a second as well. You know, the people that went out and bought the album up to this point, they've just been unreal, haven't they, really?
Yeah. I mean, in a lot of ways, it's very reflective of the rest of our career, man. You know, I mean, the UK was really the first place that really got it. And that message spread to the rest of the world. But I mean, it was so exciting for us, you know, that it all started with that first Astoria show, you know, the back when Kerrang was still doing the, you know, the special shows, you know, and they would like put the stuff on and, you know, and bring over a relatively unknown band that the hype was kind of around. It all started there, dude. And it just all snowballed in our favor to the point where, you know, 23 years later, we're just like, holy shit.
It's mad. It really is. So what does a Corey Taylor Slipknot number one album celebration look like? I mean, is there a party later on today, or are you staying in? Are you babysitting Spud?
No, I've got a show tonight, man. I'm on the road. I'm on the bus.
Are you on the bus?
I'm on a bus. Yeah. Like, I'm in the back lounge of the bus, still working my ass off. You know, that's what a celebration looks like for me, is like, cool, high five, back to work. That's what I get, you know, like, but the good thing is that tonight's the last show of the tour, on this leg. So I get to go home tonight. I get to sleep in my own bed. You know, it'll be kind of late when I get there, but it's still, there's just no better feeling than getting home to your own bed, crawling in, getting all the dogs situated, because you know they're going to eat the bed, and just trying to get, you know, trying to get some kit before you got to pick up the kids.
I mean, what a way to finish off the tour, though, with the news that you've had today. I take it you'll be talking about that on stage tonight.
Oh, 100%. Yeah. I mean, it's a global number one, because, you know, we're not sure what it's going to do in the US, but, you know, at this point, we're such a global band that's okay. You know, like, you know, obviously Bad Bunny's having his moment, and it's, you know, and that's a hard beast to go up against. But for us, for our genre, even if we come in at number two in the States, that's still a huge, huge fucking win, you know? And number one all around the world, I mean, that's like fucking getting rid of a Cadillac because it's got a scratch on it. It doesn't make sense. No sense whatsoever, you know? I will take it. It's a great reason to celebrate. We're actually, the sales are bigger than they were last time. It's just a fucking great, great problem to have, like I said before.
It really is. And what is it about this record that has, well, for you, you know, again, sort of resonated with the fans so much, do you think?
I think it's because we refuse to repeat ourselves ever. You know, we've never liked to, you know, I mean, there's a similarity, obviously, but we never like to kind of go back over the same scorched earth. Let's put it that way. We like to challenge ourselves, you know, and we like to, because we know if we challenge ourselves, it's going to challenge the listener, and that's going to help them expand their own horizons when it comes to the music that we're putting out. You know, you can't just expect the audience to get there. You have to lead them. And we keep pushing the boundaries and keep, you know, really redrawing the map as far as what Slipknot music means, you know, because it means so many different things to so many people. And that's the good thing. If it just means one thing and you try to expand yourself, you're not going to get very far. But because we started from day one, expanding the boundaries and changing the landscape for ourselves and for the listeners. Now, if you ask a group of people what Slipknot music means, you will get a very varied opinion about that because it means so many different things to so many people. There's so many great things about this band that so many different people love, from the heaviness of songs like The Dying Song and Hive Mind to the atmospheric stuff like Adderall and Finale. We refuse to be limited by limited imaginations. Ours is off the charts. So we're going to take you with us, kicking and fucking screaming if need be. And we're just going to do it our way.
It's an amazing record, a real triumph. And I, you know, as you sort of alluded to there, I mean, I saw a review recently of the record and someone was saying it's, you know, it's an experimental record. And I thought, well, hang on a minute. You're always like that. You're right. Always innovating on every record. And right. You get a real sense of it again on the new album. I mean, songs like Warranty, that's my current go-to. I absolutely love that track.
Yeah. You know what? And that song is such a satirical look at what a lot of people think about us. You know, it's just like, it's almost like that moment where Russell Crowe throws the sword in the fucking sand and spits on the ground and goes, are you not entertained? We're just like, isn't this what you came here for? The fuck out of my face. You know, like you just, every time you try to limit us, we break through whatever barriers you try to fucking put around us. And by having that kind of tongue in cheek look at it all, it keeps us from going nuts, you know, like we have to kind of laugh at it, you know, and it's beautiful because you take that line, you know, I got it all back, but I blew it on the trade-in, you know, like people will read that and go, well, what does that mean? It's like, because you think what we fucking traded on was our history, but we're actually pulling you along because of our talent, you know, and
exactly.
It's just a funny way to look and really kind of take the piss out of how serious people take this shit.
Exactly. Well, listen, man, it's an absolute triumph. You deserve everything you get. Congratulations to you, all the guys in the band as well. Just finally, before I let you go, because I know you're on stage soon, Halloween coming up. I know you're a big fan. I mean, what does that look like in the Corey Taylor household? Do you go for it?
We, you know, the funny thing is that, you know, when you have kids, you kind of let them lead the charge, you know, like, so for me, my Halloween is just the whole month of October, just getting to lean into the spooky shit, watching all the horror movies when the kids aren't around, you know, it's my Christmas basically, you know, as a former goth, exactly. As a former goth, it's my Christmas, you know? So, but when it comes to the actual day, you know, the beggar's night going out, trick or treating shit, we let the kid basically pick our costumes. I have an amazing picture of me, Alicia, and the 8-year-old are in dueling Beetlejuice outfits. And Alicia is Miss Argentina from, and we walked the neighborhood like that. So this year, the 8-year-old wants to be a Ghostbuster. So me and Alicia have to be the ghosts. So we have to, you know, we're gonna zombie it up. And she's got like the full pack. I mean, she went legit this year. Like she's got the whole thing. And we're just gonna walk around the neighborhood with weird green lassos around us and just help her get all the candy. So
nice.
Yeah,
it's nice. I'm gonna walk my road with a Michael Myers mask on, just freaking people out, just staring at them.
It will be incredibly good to do.
I'll get arrested. And just finally as well, Halloween Ends, the final Halloween film out in just like a week or so's time. How do you feel about that?
I'm stoked. You know, I love the fact that it's an enclosed story. I know a lot of people were very on the fence about how Halloween Kills was. And I've got my issues with some of it, but I loved it overall. I thought it was a great companion to the Halloween 2018 movie that came out. I think this movie is really going to do Jamie Lee her due because of that character. You know, like, there's so many shades of, you know, PTSD, survivor's guilt, so many things that go into how many layers are in this story that Gordon Green has been able to incorporate, that I think this could be one of the most brutal ones to come out, and be one of the most cathartic ones to come out as well. Cause we love these characters, you know, and it's great to see them give their due. But I think what's going to happen after this one is that it'll be a new generation that comes through. Instead of kind of going to the bank on the old ones, it'll be a new generation that comes through. So at this point, anything can happen.
It's exciting. I mean, I'm looking forward to Laurie Strode finally taking him down. Yeah. We shall see, though, right?
We shall see. Yeah, we thought she did it in the house trap. You know,
like, yeah, yeah.
We thought he did it there, but, you know, he's just a tough cookie.
He is indeed. All right, mate. Well, listen, you take care of yourself. We'll see you soon for your solo shows here in the UK as well.
Yeah, absolutely, brother. We'll see you there.
Thanks, man.
All right. Later, buddy. Yeah.